crowd noise so easily, even from the other side of the venue. And we also had games like No Fear versus Unsung Heroes that did go to Game 5. But we are jumping in now to a game between Frank's Hotdogs and, I believe, Squidlife Crisis. So we're going to be starting off here on Blackbelly Rainmaker. It's going to be a very fast-paced game. They did add a couple of walls, but it's still going to be a game that could end very easily in 30 or 45 seconds.
And right now, Purple definitely got one pick on green there.
KD having a bit of trouble getting up that pillar there.
Oh no.
One down already on the side of Squidlife Crisis, so trying to find an opportunity to pick up that Rainmaker. They're also expending a Stingray here, and they're going to make the first push of the day.
That's going to be very useful, though. We're going to be trying to take the center way in, and gets a couple flanks on the side there. Green going to be getting a couple picks on Hotdogs.
That's a three down situation there for Squidlife Crisis, though, or for Frank's Hotdogs, rather. So they already expended a lot of resources, including a Stingray and an Inkcloud. Unfortunate death there for Mr. Typhoon, so that should give Frank's Hotdogs enough time to get back into the game. But for now, it's going to be Squidlife Crisis picking up the Rainmaker.
And they did get a pretty good, pretty nicely there for now. 4 minutes in. Oh, wait. Flank situation coming in from the back. Not going to get that flank. Toasty Wave is going to try and run that duck down the left path. Biscuit getting that.
Nice double kill, and the squid back to go with it. A three down situation. That was huge. There were two members of Frank's Hotdogs that were behind the Rainmaker, one of them dead and one of them waiting for a person that was not coming. So that was a massive double kill to stop what could have been a game-changing push.
Very true. And oh wait. They have
Speaking
the Rainmaker. Moose came back
pushes,
in there.
The absolute steal by Moose, who's going to get
gonna
it all the way to 60. What an advance there.
Not going to get the lead just yet. We're going to see that Stingray going to be coming out, going to be trying to capture anyone trying to run in and get that Rainmaker when they can.
Yeah, this is one of the best places on this map to use the Stingray, so that's a great zoning.
It's such a choke.
Special.
It's such a choke.
It's beautiful, and we also saw the Inkstorm coming out there, so that's going to provide a bit of passive map control. Katie
gets the double kill. I saw
beautiful
it.
Job there. You can just plant it at your feet, and
she's running it
all the way up. Not quite to the 44 mark again, but they're three down, so Frank's Hotdogs is going to have another opportunity to push. Biscuit picking it up and gets it all the way to 36.
Melee canceled.
Not a bad push at all.
No kidding. I saw the roller coming down there for a second as we cut away. I thought that was it. But no, Katie able to manage to push that into a really good spot for a second there. And now it is on Squidlife Crisis trying to push that right back in. They need to get that lead, man.
They also need to get a bit more map control. We see members of Frank's Hotdogs are bunched up over in this half pipe. They have to be careful of the Stingray that's bearing down on them. One down for each team, and the Rainmaker will fall. Nice job there, Biscuit. About halfway up to a Stingray there, which has been so nice to have on this map and just about any map in the game.
Okay, Frank's Hotdogs, yeah, you were right, though. Frank's Hotdogs really does have a lot of control, and you can see right now Squidlife Crisis trying to take a look back a little bit. Oh, I thought that Autobahn was going to get our Splatling friend up there.
That's a two-down situation, though. We're seeing the Stingray now coming out from the sloshing machine. Mr. Kabam trying to run that Rainmaker down. They only have a bit of room to maneuver around, and they might have overextended a bit there. A full wipe coming up for Frank's Hotdogs, and they still have two members left. They might be able to bum rush this one and get an extension on their lead.
That would be very solid. 36 to 60. That's a little bit of a lead, but frankly, you know, one strong push, a couple strong wipes, that'll change pretty fast.
I see what you did there. Frankly, for Frank's Hotdogs, not bad. Mr. Kabam getting a nice kill with that hero Splatling, which we've actually seen a good amount in this tournament. It's become a pretty popular weapon. Punctual, not going to pop the Ink Armor before picking up the Rainmaker, and we'll just barely get
it
away.
Somehow squeeze it in there. Oh my god.
Somehow jumping their way to success and getting an extra 5 points.
Yeah, that was a very solid push. Very solid push. I mean, honestly, the further push, you know, they don't have to win. They don't have to win right now. As long as they keep that lead, especially, you know, 1 minute, 30 seconds in here, it's going to be pretty good. Anything they can get is pretty good.
Moose going to be the one elected to pick up the Rainmaker here for Squidlife Crisis. Mr. Kabam trying to use that cover to both use their main weapon and now the Stingray to try and take some members down. They get some damage in, but it's not going to result in a final kill. Meanwhile, Frank's Hotdog's still two down, and Moose is trying to go it by themselves. There's only a couple people coming back from spawn.
They're all responding.
And they're going to get all the way to 40. If they can keep this Rainmaker here, they might be able to get the lead at 30.
Oh my gosh, that was an interesting push, but no, that was an unfortunate thing. Everyone was coming back from spawn at that exact second.
Squidlife Crisis drawn like moths to a flame to that Rainmaker, and unfortunately they're going to pay for it and have to try again. Three down now for Squidlife Crisis as Frank's Hotdogs is somewhat sitting on their laurels here. They have the map control and they also have the lead.
Yeah, that push is not going to happen at that exact moment. I was hoping to see a little bit of action there. Oh, that Splatling's going to be coming in.
Katie actually gets the kill there onto Moose, looking for a second one as they go down, but they're not going to find it. It's actually two down for both teams, and now Mr. Kabam, who does have that Stingray at the ready, trying to babysit the Rainmaker as they look for their final push.
All right, and now we're coming right back into it. Mr. Typhoon, seeing if you can find anyone up front here. Going to go try and get the high ground. Oh, sees the Blaster up top. Going to begin that Blaster pick. Sees the Stingray. Not the source of it yet. Trying to find the source of it. Goes under there.
They still just have so little map control to contend with. This is going to have to be an overtime push if they can even pick it up. The ink on Katie is going to be able to survive, but they'll go down. Two down for both sides, but it's not going to be enough.
Game one for Frank's Hot Dogs.
Beautiful job
right there.
Squidlife Crisis actually had a couple of really nice moments. They tried to just rush the Rainmaker in a very aggressive style and made it all the way to 40 because of it. They caught a couple members behind the play, and it was only because of those members that were sitting at spawn that they were stopped.
Yeah. No, honestly, without those kills, without those kills sending them back to the spawn, they may have actually had that push coming right in.
It's such a fun map and mode combination to watch. It's always very hectic. A lot of aggressive play is benefited here. And it was actually a really close battle, too. So that gives me hope that this one could potentially go to the final game of the set.
Yeah, no kidding, man. Rainmaker is wild. Rainmaker is wild.
It's just a wild, especially on smaller maps like that. The Muscle Forge Fitness map has the same sort of dilemma where you can basically jump down from that top platform and get 30 or 40 points immediately.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Especially, Humpback Pump Track.
Yes.
I've seen that too. Oh, that's my favorite one. Humpback Pump Track, Rainmaker. Just seeing people go back and forth and all of a sudden that quick 30-40 skip when they come up the side. Oh my God. I was talking to some players today and they, you know, it's very fun to watch, very stressful to play.
Oh, heck yeah. Especially when you're the defending team and you see those numbers just jump up immediately. It's very terrifying.
There's no panic like it.
The Reef has the same sort of thing because they can just take it straight up the alleyway. The only obstacle there is that car, which isn't until you get to around the 20 or 15 mark.
That's right. Yeah, that's true. And you know what? That's where Stingray may come into play. That's where Stingray may come into play, just to try and snuff out any approaches there.
Stingray so powerful on just about every map and mode combination. It sounds like we're getting into our game shortly
right here.
It looks like it will be Moray Towers, and it is Splat Zones. It is still a two-zone map, but in the Splatoon 2 iteration of this map, the zones have migrated right to the middle.
That's right. Oh, that's right. In Splatoon 1, they were separated. So yeah, now everything, all the conflict is pointing at these two little areas. And it just becomes a little bit of a game of can you jump between the two points if you want to control one point or another. Two control points, Splat Zones are very interesting to watch.
The zones also felt a lot smaller, and they were at the other extremes of the map instead of both being right in the middle of the map. So unlike Rainmaker and Tower Control, most of the fighting is going to take place right here in the middle of the map. Nice kill there by Moose onto Punctual, who's going to barely stay alive thanks to the splashdown and get a kill. It's not called the panic button special for nothing.
No kidding, man. Splashdown is such a good way to just get out of a situation because it puts you up in the air. It sort of gives you like this cloak for a second of you're able to, especially if you have like a curling bomb, a splat bomb, something just to get yourself out of there real fast. Very effective tool.
Just having that ink under you is so nice for getting away. Speaking of splashdowns, we're seeing one now from Tasty Waves. They're not going to get a kill there. A teammate's going to clean them up, but it looks like so far a beautiful job's being done here by Squidlife Crisis to try and come back. They're already into the mid-30s.
That's very true, and yeah, at a moment there were Hot Dogs
the bubbles
almost
blocking
captured the second
their
point.
Shot, looking for any kills, but the bubbles acting as a shield. Mr. Kabam gonna clean up Katie there, where it looks like Frank's Hot Dogs might have an advantage. Now Squidlife Crisis is gonna stop them, and they're only gonna have one more push to go.
No kidding, we were talking about phenomenal specials, the bubbler. The bubbler, it's so good at like just keeping people away because you don't want to approach it. You never want to approach it.
Katie getting a nice kill there, but it's not going to be enough. We're now into single digits here for Squidlight Crisis.
Alive. The baller
stopped at five just for
that
a second.
That gal is going to get one kill. It's not enough.
It's not going to be enough.
That
what
was
a
so
comeback
close
there. Squidlight Crisis showing like a different team, essentially, from game one.
No kidding. That was so dominant. That was so dominant the entire time. Hot Dog tried to come back as best they could. We almost saw it at the very end with that gal, but just not enough.
And you don't think of Moray Towers as being a map that really goes that quickly. That one was much quicker than the Rainmaker map we just saw.
No kidding, because it's not easier, but having two control points, having two splat zones, it's a little bit easier to just get control of one, just to stop the clock, just to stop the timer.
And the fact that they're right next to each other, Manta Maria is kind of the same way in that both zones are right next to each other in the middle, only separated by that mast. And speaking of Manta Maria, we're actually going to be going there now, but for tower control. And Manta Maria in general is just such an interesting map. The middle part of it's very open. You have the center and then those two courts on the left and right-hand side. But then behind that, on both ends of the map, there's a ton of walls and a couple of jumping off points as well.
And again, that, you know, I keep on talking about, but the Stingray. The Stingray is going to be so useful, just avoiding all those walls. Who needs walls when you just have this nice piercing damage that might as well sink the entire ship when you cut a giant line through it, but eh.
They're not too worried about that, I suppose. But maps that are so narrow and vertical, like Manta Maria and Port Mackerel, just have such a layout that makes the Stingray excel, because you can just aim it. There's only so much room for the other squids to maneuver around in, and you can pick up some free kills, especially with the extra range that they added in one of the most recent patches.
Plus, with things like Rainmaker and Tower Control, you're able to aim directly at the objective and just pressure it. Hey, you want to go on this objective? Well, fight my laser first.
Especially for Tower Control, it's going to be so, so nice. We're also seeing a Luna Blaster come out on the side of Frank's Hot Dogs. That's going to give them a baller. It was nerfed after patch 1.4, but it's still going to be a very potent special. And also the Ink Armor coming out from the end zap on both sides. They're going to try and rely on that to survive a little bit of extra damage.
Looks like there's going to be a lot of tower pressure coming out from Squidlife Crisis there, thanks to that Luna Blaster, thanks to that washing machine.
Both teams going with a relatively aggro build. The only mid to long range weapons we're seeing is the heavy Splatling, I believe, coming out from Squidlife Crisis. We are seeing a nice kill there from the Sloshing Machine. Biscuit going to try and get on the tower, but they'll go down immediately to Moose, who's going to pop that splash down. Three down on the side of Squidlife Crisis, so that's going to allow for the first push of the game. Other than that one, to go to Frank's Hot Dogs, and they will gain the lead because of it.
Yeah, Tasty Wave's coming in. They're going to get one kill and going to try and hold this tower for a little bit, definitely in this little early bit. I've seen games that never go past the 80 mark. But something tells me this game will definitely make it past that point. Toasty Wave's going to be coming in, taking control of the tower for a little bit there. Oh, Moose coming in from behind, actually securing a kill.
Yeah, nice shot there. They're going to lose their Ink Armor. They have the splashdown at the ready and a two-down situation here for Frank Toss.
Splashdown!
What was that? They got stuck under the tower.
It got caught on the rim.
Oh my gosh, I've never seen that before.
That can happen on anything that has a roof. And in a case like that, that could be good and that could be bad, because sometimes you aim above when you see a splashdown. But in that case, they didn't move at all.
So they stay alive somehow. Genie not suffering the same fate as they'll go down. Nice kill there by Mr. Kabam on a punctual, who's just staying back here with this heavy Splatling. There's a big court area for them to hang around in, and because of it, they've built up their Stingray, and they're going to try and get some spawners that are coming in.
Right now, Squidlife Crisis did manage to get rid of that first checkpoint, so it's going to be a little bit of an easier push for them versus Frank's Hot Dogs. And ooh, a little bit of contesting with the Luna Blaster, but is going to go down.
Yeah, 68, definitely not a sound push, but they've gotten Frank's Hot Dogs two down already, so they're extending it now into the 50s. Three specials at the ready for them. They're just missing that Ink Armor. Nice kill there on the Moose. They're going to have to retreat behind that wall and come back around to see if they can get on the tower, stopping them before they get to the 50 mark. That's a huge stop, at least for now. Nice kill there on the Tasty Waves and the double over the tower on the Mr. Typhoon. Even though we went down on that one, that's a major stop right before they got to the halfway mark.
And as we've seen, that Sloshing Machine is so good at just pressuring a point. It just, like, hey, I'm behind a wall. Speaking of walls, this entire map is about walls.
Heck yeah.
If you're behind a wall and you can just keep lobbing those powered shots right over, it's going to be really good things. But speaking of power, ooh, this baller got a little bit nerfed to power recently, but it's still nothing to overlook.
Yeah, neither is that Splat Bomb that's going to take down Moose. 1.4 really did deal with a baller, but not the Stingray. The Stingray's still an incredibly potent special, one of the best in the game, in my opinion. And now, finally, we're seeing a pretty big push here from Frank's Hot Dogs. Ooh. The Luna Genie cannot stay alive. Nice maneuvering there by Mr. Typhoon. They recently buffed the ends up to where it has even more maneuverability.
You can now walk faster with it. Like, run speed is incredible with NZAP right now. And plus, with the armor and suction bomb it has on it, it's a very, very strong build.
Ink Armor itself, weapon. Still a very good special. Biscuit has to back off, has to find a good spot.
How did they get away? You were talking about
those walls. They sure came in clutch there for Biscuit.
No kidding. And now he's just going to put some more pressure on the point, trying to guard his teammates. Another splashdown going to be coming out.
It is Splashdown City here as we see Biscuit trying to hold it down along with Punctual. Moose aiming to get some kills there, though. Three down on the side of Frank's Hot Dogs, and now we're seeing the Stingray come out as a last-ditch effort here.
Kerfuffle in the
trying
middle
to find
this.
Some kills. Mr. Typhoon not getting on the tower yet. A teammate will take up that job, but they need to try and defend the tower as best they can. They already have the lead, but if they can keep extending the tower into the enemy zone, they will have a good shot to take this game.
And having that Stingray back there and having that Splatling in general back there is going to be very useful for just getting back into the game as you can jump to them.
Mr. Kabam having to back off both teams, one down so far, and it looks like Frank's Hot Dogs are finally getting some map control here in mid. The splashdown not going to be activated as it's two down now for Frank's Hot Dogs. They do have one at the ready, essentially a three down situation as that splash, that splatter shot will also go down. So a nice opportunity here for Squidlife Crisis to maintain their lead.
Also, as a small detail, but I got to give appreciation to that cute little placement of the sprinkler. Just keeping that right on top of the grate, putting on a little bit of ink coverage, to the center of the map.
And speaking of grates, that's where something like a heavy splat lane can excel. Kelp Dome is the exact same way. Those grates are an excellent place for them to walk around. Nice trade there on a Mr. Kabam. A two-down situation on the Squidlife Crisis as they try and extend their lead. Moose having a bit of difficulty getting on the tower. They'll get on just in time to die to Katie. And it'll be 30 seconds left for Frank's Hot Dog to get to that 49 mark.
And it just goes back and forth and back and forth right now. This game is, like as you said in the very beginning, it's just going to keep staying even.
It's a bloodbath like we'd expect on something like Blackbelly Skate Park. No again, map control here in mid is being pretty evenly split here. Another Stingray coming out, and a Stingray at the ready here for Mr. Kabam. Yeah. Smartly going to hide behind a wall to activate it here.
Right
with
now?
5 seconds left to go, this will be the last push of the day for Frank's Hot Dogs.
Pressure in the point right now. Not going to let Green
get anything.
Somebody
has to get on the tower to fight that, but they
can't. Can you?
It's so wide that it just takes up the entire room on the tower. Beautiful win there.
It's uncontestable. You really just have to take him out before he takes out your entire opportunity to get on the point and win the game.
And where Frank's Hot Dogs excelled in game number one, Squidlife Crisis has done a fantastic job of coming back. We see Mr. Kabam with a 16 KA on that heavy Splatling. So excited to see how this turns out in game number four.
No kidding. Solid defense from the Splatling. That's definitely one of, or I'd say the best strong suit of the Splatling. Being able to just stay back there, stay on defense as soon as you get the laser charge. Just let it rip. Let it rip, let it go, man.
And I think both of those teams had a really good defense. I mean, getting to just 50 on a map like this one is not bad, but it's also usually not a winning push. We've seen in this tournament alone a couple of knockouts on Manta Maria Tower Control. So to see both of these teams not get past the 50 mark speaks to the amount of patience they have, their willingness to stay back, and of course, the Stingray usage. A lot of that sort of play lends itself to staying back, hiding behind a wall, and picking people off from afar.
Yeah, like I was saying in the very beginning, like I've seen games that just really never get past the 80 mark. It's just a matter of how far, how much you're going to go back and forth and back and forth to wipe, to wipe, to wipe, to wipe, to see how far you can push it. And that game, you know, I think the checkpoint played a lot.
And also just the strategies of both these teams. It was such a juxtaposition because in game number one, Rainmaker on Blackbelly, we saw a lot of people just trying to bummish the Rainmaker into the enemy spawn. And now as we come to Rainmaker on Humpback Pump Track, we may get to see that same thing again. It's a bit bigger of a map, and there's a lot less obstacles to contend with.
Also, there's something I'd like to mention is that normally when you play Splatoon, it's all online. It's all online. Here, we have a crowd. We have everyone's in the same room right now. I will admit that those rooms right there that they're all playing in are very isolated. But oh my goodness, that can pressure you.
But they have a direct window to the audience there. Nice kill there by Moose. It's a two-down situation for both teams, and Moose is going to be brave enough to pick up that Rainmaker despite only having one other envoy with him.
Oh,
and
pressured.
Enemy teammates right on top of them. They'll only get to the 84 mark, and their teammates will come back from spawn.
This entire game is 2v2s. This entire game is 2v2s. Two down, two down, 2v2, 2v2. And right now, this Stingray pressure is going to be doing pretty good work, as now Green is Hot Dog is going to be trying to get control of this point and try to find a way in. And we were talking earlier about this, that this is one of those maps. Oh, that Stingray pressure. This is one of those maps that all of a sudden a score can look pretty far apart. It'll jump in a second.
It's also a map that has a ton of flanking potential, as you can basically get anywhere on the map using that large outer ring. And so, of course, Stingray coming in very huge here, both teams utilizing it, and both teams still utilizing that end zap that we've seen a lot this tournament. We are also seeing both teams now have a heavy splatling. So, as we see Frank's Hot Dogs pick up the Rainmaker, nice kill there on a Mr. Typhoon in the form of a trade, but it's going to be a three-down situation and absolute bloodbath once again.
It's a double three-down situation. This keeps happening and happening, man. We're going to probably keep on seeing it happen and happen through the rest of the
set. Biscuit was trying to be patient, but was a little too complacent. There's the Rainmaker is going to be able to get the lead all the way up to 66. Tasty Waves with the almost C9S push there is going to be able to gain the lead. Still plenty of time left on the clock, and Frank's Hot Dogs has three specials, now four to use.
Man, that poor 3v1 for a second there. It's a hard life when you're the Rainmaker and no one else is around to defend against the 3v1. They did a good job just pushing that as they can. And right now we're going to see Hot Dog trying to
kill there onto Moose. And Biscuit blazing a path here as Punctual's going to gain the lead with the Rainmaker.
Oh, the
three down still on the side of Squidlife Crisis. So I bet this push is not nearly over.
Oh, definitely not. But everyone is responding right now.
Oh my gosh.
It's the same situation that happened before. It's everyone responding, everyone coming in, and everyone just jumping on the Rainmaker with incredible pressure.
All four members of Squidlife Crisis bunched up together. But Frank's Hot Dog's got exactly what they came for. And 23 is a pretty pretty fantastic push on this map. Mr. Kabam trying to do a solo push, not nearly advisable. They need to work a little bit more on gaining some map control back, because so far, it's all in Frank's Hot Dog's colors.
And I did love how as soon as they got close to that wall, it was a rain of burst bombs. It was a rain of burst bombs. Everyone knew what they were trying, but unfortunately, he was the only one pushing alone.
That's the nice thing about those burst bombs, that instant detonation, and they have a pretty large blast radius as well. We're seeing Mr. Typhoon now try and paint the middle of the map and build up that ink armor in the process. Takes down the ink armor, punctual, but it's not enough to gain the kill.
Armor.
They survived
saved them
with one hit, and as you said, the ink armor was the one thing they needed, but a full wipe onto Squidlife Crisis, including taking down the heavy Splatling, who had that Stingray at the ready. So Frank's Hot Dogs going to get a chance to extend their lead, or at least keep the Rainmaker for a while.
Keep the Rainmaker just away from, oh, where would it be difficult,
what
but Moose
a vertical slam.
Coming in there with the hammer down, making this look like Overwatch. Oh my god, it's going to be getting that splat, getting that kill. But right now it is still in Frank's Hot Dogs' favor, but here comes that Ink Bleaker, the Stingray.
Glad to see you're a man of culture as well with the Overwatch references. We're seeing Frank's Hot Dogs just keep this Rainmaker over by this wall. They're basically running out the clock on Squidlife Crisis. Only about a minute and a half for them to try and contend. Beautiful jumping kill there by Katie, looking for the double, but Moose was ready
Moose
for it.
Again.
I believe Moose is going to get the double kill instead.
Oh my goodness, that was a great little poke by Katie. They're just waiting there, Had their opportunity, went in there and got the kill. But right now, this is a very strong push for Moose. However, Biscuit coming in from the side, going to be getting two people, including the Rainmaker. Three! Oh my goodness.
Yeah, Biscuit prioritizing the VIP target there and getting the Rainmaker down. Only one member alive for Frank's Hot Dogs, and it is going to be that heavy Splatling with the Stingray in tow, so they'll be able to play a bit of defense here as Squidlife Crisis tries to pop this shield. Only under a minute left here, and now the Stingray is going to come out from Genie, looking for some people that are behind the Rainmaker shield, but the one that was there already went down.
That's true, and right now they're just looking to hold their lead. We got 50 seconds left, and oh my gosh, you can already score twice and back in 50 seconds on this map. It's so easy.
Stingray coming out now from Squidlife Crisis, and they have a splashdown as well to contend with, trying to stay alive, and here comes the splashdown. Not going to find anybody.
Scary.
The Rainmaker trying to push, but they don't have any map control to contend with. Mr. Typhoon trying to get ahead. Mr. Punctual's going to take him down, and that's
it's a full wipe.
I'm not sure they're going to be able to get to the Rainmaker in time. I think Frank's Hot Dogs can just camp it by their spawn.
Right now, they just it's just a defending game.
And if that happens, we'll need to go to a game five.
We'll see a game five, potentially. Oh, Moose coming around the side. Moose has made plays before. Going to get Katie. This is a chance, although they have the Stingray on point. Oh my gosh, it's so overwhelmingly on Green's favor right now. That Stingray.
Janie getting flanked.
Coming in from the back.
Beautiful kill by Tasty Wave.
There's a chance.
And no, they're not going to pop the Rainmaker shield in time. Time not on their side. And Frank's Hot Dog going to outlive a massive scare there.
Wow.
Unbelievable.
That was so intense. Are you kidding me? You can't even get any closer for it to pop. I think if you check the frame data, you got to bring up the wiki. You got to bring up the numbers, the calculator. I don't think we could get a single millisecond more damage on that before it popped.
Literally 1 second separating them from having a last second push. Their Squidlife Crisis being
potential for that push.
Ousted. I cannot believe that. Three down, and even Genie, who had that Stingray popped, got flanked at the very end there, I believe, by Tasty Wave. So.
And they wouldn't have really had to even KO'd. That was the opportunity right there. Not saying they would have had it, but because everyone would have been responding about that point. Maybe. But they might have had the chance.
Even in a five-minute game, time can often run out on you in just a second or two's time. So.
Pump track Rainmaker, man. It's a beast all in of its own.
I mean, most Rainmaker maps are fun like that just because your squid, whoever's carrying the Rainmaker, they determine the pace at which the objective moves. So if you are running somebody that has a bunch of swim speed or run speed, they can carry that Rainmaker so, so quickly before the enemy team can even contend with it.
That's very true. That's very true. So, any idea where we're going to be going for game number five?
Not yet. I have not seen a map list. I believe they are resetting up the lobby here as we go into game five. But so far, it's been a very back and forth series. I wouldn't say either team has a drastic advantage here. And it's been incredibly fun to watch as well.
No kidding. You called it in the beginning, like I just said. This is a very, very back-and-forth game. Makes it very hard to predict the winner of this.
We haven't even made it to our top 12 action.
No kidding. This is bronze. This is bronze.
Unbelievable.
You guys better be ready for a good day of Splatoon, because we are all Hey, who's ready in the venue here for a good day of Splatoon right now?
Woo!
Let's go,
champ. So excited to see the rest of these matches. And I guess we got to talk about the team comps. They've been relatively similar. We've seen both teams in multiple games carry with them an Inzap, a heavy Splatling, and then the other two are where they seem to vary. I know one of them is favoring the Sloshing Machine because they love that Stingray so much. It's come in clutch a couple of times. And the base weapon itself, it has such a large hitbox, a lot larger than you might think.
No kidding. It's absolutely necessary. In games like these, and as we mentioned, with a bunch of opportunities to just stay in the back and get as many kills as you possible. It really sort of obsoletes tent missiles in a sad way, because I'm a big fan, tent of missiles fan. I like seeing it in action, but man, when Stingray is something, and, you know, you just hop back to the, you know, stay in the back and let it go, sort of takes its slot. Poor guys.
Yeah, I'm a bit surprised that specials that are sort of underutilized right now and not really in the meta, like the Inkjet, like the Tenet Missiles, they've seen a decent amount of play. I've seen a couple people bring out the Splat Dualies. I've seen some End Parry Dualies. I've seen a couple of other Inkjet weapons that I didn't think I would be seeing.
The Dually Squelchers, speaking of things that have the that have the 1.4 touch.
Yes.
Oh, boy, I love the Dually Squelchers ever since then, because for those who are out of the loop, after you roll with the Dually Squelchers, or after you roll with any Dualies, normally you're sort of stuck in a set location for a little bit. You get two rolls, but you can't really move. Dually Squelchers now have a little bit of drift potential. After you move, you can move a little bit more. So, I mean, personally, that's been a big thing for a lot of people, because a lot of people like to be able to be constantly in control of their character. And having that ability to just constantly be on the move and keep a point sensor going and firing some Tenta missiles when they need to be, it's a pretty good idea. It's a pretty good carry.
Right.
Good weapon
now. It's a similar idea to Drop Roller, which I believe also got buffed pretty recently.
Oh, yes.
Being able to roll in any direction that much quicker can save you from being hit by something like a bomb or a sniper that's pointed directly at you, and you can throw them for a loop and catch them off guard and get the kill on them instead of the other way around.
And that's a very important thing. If you're jumping in there and you need to get a kill, and all of a sudden you turn your one down into their two down, that's invaluable.
But now we move on to game number 5. It is going to be Splat Zones on Sturgeon Shipyard. One zone map. We have the middle part and then the shoulders that are covered by that Splat Zone area. Moose trying to get some kills from a distance. We'll find it with the short flicks onto Katie. And it looks like because of that, the Squidlife Crisis is going to gain the zone first.
And all of a sudden, oh my gosh, they got so close for a second. They were close to pressuring that Stingray. But then the baller comes in, steamrolls, and literally rolls on top of them.
And I really like this choice here by Genie, bringing in a weapon with both the Sprinkler and, of course, that Stingray that can stay back and melt people down from a distance. And we see Tasty Waves there on that mini Splatling. The
first
bomb
one I've seen today.
With that instant detonation and then the Tenta Missiles, which can locate multiple targets.
We're talking about the Tenta Missiles. They're trying to prove me wrong. I love seeing them, don't get me wrong, but Moose right now, oh my gosh, we've seen a lot of good stuff from Moose with that Splat Roller, but not that death.
Yeah, the Splat Roller has come a lot into favor because it has the curling bomb. It can get into the action so quickly. The baller we see now trying to get into the action here, but it's going to be a little too hasty, as Frank's Hotdog's going to still have control of the zone, but now Squidlife Crisis having a bit more of an advantage here. Mr. Kabam hanging out on the top part of the zone, and they do have that bubble blower at the ready, which is another special we haven't seen all that often, but especially on Splat Zones, it can be so potent.
Right now, Genie was doing an excellent job just guarding their own point for right now. Just trying to keep Orange off of it. Just trying to keep them away.
Didn't even need to pop the bubble to get that kill on the biscuit there. That is going to be the lead gained here for Frank's Hotdogs, as Katie is sort of babysitting this zone here with those burst bombs, also trying to build up that Splat Zone. The mini Splatling gets in there. Katie gets a couple of hits. We'll finally take them down. A double kill there on the Moose and Tasty Wave.
Oh!
And a beautiful job there as they look for the triple 3 down on the side of Squidlife Crisis.
Man, that's an unfortunate moment when you're going, good kill right there. But that's a very fortunate moment when you see that one missile, the one marked missile, and it's like, there's nothing else. You just walk right into it and get Splat. A very good job avoiding that. But right now, Hotdogs in control of the map, trying to keep it without any extra points going on their side. They have to get rid of a little bit more of the map there.
I don't think Squidlife Crisis can get back. They have two down. The baller pops
and
for extra
that
effect. That is going to do it.
Wow.
Well done there. Frank's Hotdogs going to be locking game 5 down on Sturgeon Shipyard.
Now we saw Frank's Hotdogs win the first one. Then it came back 2 on the other team. Hotdogs won the fourth game, sort of making a little bit of a sandwich out of the bracket there. I mean, whenever I see a first game won by one team and then the next team starts to win 2, you usually think momentum. Momentum is a huge part in esports, in sports in general. And when you win 2 in a row, sometimes that's enough to get the third, but sometimes you also just can't hold it for long enough
Absolutely. We see, as you said, we saw Frank's Hot Dogs win the first one, Squidlife Crisis come back, win the next two, and now it's been the other way around. Frank's Hot Dogs winning game four and five. So now as we move on to game number six, Tower Control on Kelp Dome, which is a very fun map. And again, we talked about the Rainmaker. You can move at your own pace. The Tower, you're kind of stuck, especially with those checkpoints.
That's very true. Definitely different from Rainmaker. Definitely different from Rainmaker. Rainmaker is so, as you mentioned before, it's in control of the players. I personally like Tower Control just because there's a little bit more of a like payload aspect.
Right.
Comparing it
of
to
course, with
Overwatch
the Overwatch
and TF2.
Again.
Yeah. For those familiar with Overwatch, for those familiar with TF2. New to the Splatoon community, it's going to be a little bit more like that than Rainmaker.
But Tower Control, I mean, with the tower goes on a fixed path, so you don't have the option of, say, like in Rainmaker, taking it on the grates or going directly to the choke point. You have to go all the way around to where the bush used to be in Splatoon 1. And let's see with the weapons that they have brought with them. Both teams opting for a heavy splatling, one being the Deco variant. I think that's an excellent option with all these grates and catwalks that are around.
Definitely going to be having the option to just throw out the bubbler again. As we mentioned before, the bubbler is going to be a very good pressuring. That sprinkler right in the middle.
Ooh.
Actually going to be trying to get a little bit of area control right around the middle.
Yeah,
so Typhoon's
Moose
coming in from the side, just going to see if there's anyone around there. Yeah, Moose has been doing some good
Moose
stuff.
Moose also,
today.
I mean, they just straight up bum rush the middle
part
of the map. Nice kill. And that's the beauty of the splat roller. You can just get right into the enemy spawn.
He just gets out there.
And specials are coming out like crazy. We see the bubble boar. We see the stingray. Now we now see a stingray coming out from Squidlife Crisis as they'll get a kill on the genie. Looking for the double, they'll find it in the form of an assist. And now Squidlife Crisis looking to tie this one up at three.
Mr. Command was doing such a good job just poking, just getting some damage wherever he could find it.
That was effectively a full wipe as well onto Frank's Hot Dog. So a huge push starting us out here for Squidlife Crisis, and they're still getting kills here.
This is incredible. This is very incredible. And that splatling on top of the point is going to be another stingray.
This is one of the best
flank coming around the side
for stingray as well.
There was a flank coming around the side, but that was quickly snuffed out. However, Mr. Command still in control of this point. Hasn't
what
let it
a
go.
Three down situation on the Frank's Hot Dog.
There's
but
no
they're
going
to go down. Mr. Typhoon staying alive, but only the sloshing machine
there's
remains.
No wall that
they
can pass stop this
checkpoint
point.
Two. Mr. Typhoon going to go down, but
they
that will do
sweep.
It.
They
Squidlife Crisis
sweep.
Is going to take this one to a game seven and tie the setup at three.
This goes back and forth and back and forth. We were talking about Rainmaker, how you can just see these quick 1 second like sweeps. We're seeing it on Tower Control. That was so dominant. If you looked at that game in isolation, compared it to the rest of the set, you'd think this was a completely different game.
Exactly. It feels like these are completely different teams.
You cannot
every single
tell
time
what's
we watch
next.
Them. Their weapons are similar, but the emphasis with which they're putting on each push in every game is so, so different in every single map mode combination. Like for this one, Squidlife Crisis did not show any signs of weakness. They built up those specials, they got the early picks, and they were able to take that first push of the game all the way to the KO spot.
And this is Bronze Finals. This is bronze.
And we're going
finals.
To a game seven.
We
cannot ask for anything better.
We could ask for maybe like a longer time in the venue because we might actually hit a timeout point at a certain time here if we see silver, gold, and the rest of top 12 go to.
I am hoping that happens because this crowd has been hyped already. And as we get later in the day, it's only going to get more hyped, more energetic, and more dramatic.
Top six is going to be incredible. That's all I'm saying. Top six is going to be incredible.
I don't know what's going to happen, but I think
incredible.
People are going to be on their feet cheering for whichever team they want to win. And I hope the same will go for this game number seven between Squidlife Crisis and Frank's Hot Dogs. I see a couple of them trying to quench their thirst before this stressful moment.
Man, I gotta say, this little venue, as a shout out to the venue, this venue is very nice.
Absolutely.
Nice food, nice drinks. Come on by Squidstorm, your local Boston.
Game number seven going to be taking place here. Rainmaker on Port Mackerel. Let's see what they've brought with them. For Frank's Hot Dogs, it's going to be the double splatter shot combo, including one of them running three mains worth of swim speed.
Oh my god. Yeah, that's very true. And right now, we still see Moose holding on with that roller, man. I want to see some more stuff from Moose here. Ooh, that stingray going to be wiping out Mr. Typhoon right here as we see a complete domination.
Big three-down situation, and here comes Katie running the Rainmaker down. Going to pop that special, and they're going to go
kill.
Down because
gets
of it.
One.
That's a huge stop.
This
but
is still in their push. This is still in their push.
Squidlife Crisis still
they have a
three
huge
down.
Chance.
Punctual,
huge
blazing
chance.
A path here, but they're going to get melted
this
down.
No.
Stopped at the 38 mark, but for the first 40 seconds of
it's
the
still
game,
not over.
That's a fantastic push.
They can honestly, the push may not still be full completion right here as long as as long as Blue can remain alive and get allow people to squid jump back to them, it can still work out. But that being said, Squidlife Crisis is doing a good job at just trying to bring it back a little bit here.
You can see how much map control they have to get back here. Frank's Hot Dogs has done a fantastic job in the early game here of pressuring them. They're using those two short-range weapons along with the end zap, so three really
Moose
to try and get
in.
Them down. But now there's three special at the ready
coming
here.
From the side. Moose is going prices. Wild, man.
Moose staying alive, getting the kill on the KD and popping that splash down to stay alive.
He does it again.
As they're trying to go for the splash down, and Mr. Typhoon trying to blaze a path. They're going to get the kill, or trade actually, with Ritual.
Did not get the
three down, two down for both sides now, and the Rainmaker stopped 1 point away from taking that lead.
Moose making their own splashdown here. Moose making their own splashdown. Say, I see your splashdown. I didn't figure out a way to nerf it with my own primary.
Unbelievable play by the Splat Roller Moose, and now this Rainmaker just sitting up top here. They have the sprinkler.
There's still getting Moose coming in from behind.
Oh my gosh, these flanks are unreal.
Oh, and now the splashdown.
Miss can barely avoid it, and Miss will finally go down. Three down situation on this Squidlife Crisis, and that will finally end what was a fantastic push at 39.
I have never seen a Moose kill a man. Personally, I've never seen a Mills kill a man. I've seen this one out here killing 20.
You've seen it once, twice. It's a complete Moose massacre here today. Tasty Waves now trying to maintain control of mid here. And there's that Moose on the left-hand side. They're not even going to go for them, not even going to bother dealing with them at close range. Tasty Waves trying to build up that splashdown and also pop the Rainmaker, but they'll go down with that splashdown in tow. Two down on the side of Squidlife Crisis as Frank's Hot Dogs tries to use that Stingray to pop the Rainmaker.
Oh my gosh, this has been an incredible Game 7 so far. This is a Game 7 with a 1 point difference.
Mr.
Tell your
Kabam
friends, people. Tell your friends.
Going to be the designated Rainmaker carrier here for Squidlife Crisis. Genie and Biscuit trying to pressure them. Kabam smartly trying to wait for their teammates to clean up some kills here. They're going to get behind these shipping crates, but they're being targeted from up top.
Oh, got
and
pin.
They will get caught in the fire of three different members of Frank's Hot Dogs.
Oh, this
here.
Is it.
But
this
what
is
a touchdown.
Oh, oh, this is just not
three
enough.
Three down situation and
Biscuit
a bit of squid
celebrating.
Here for Biscuit.
Biscuit the they want to eat a biscuit. They want to eat the hot dogs. They're getting eaten by the food.
You're never too far into a set to squid bag, apparently. That's what I've learned here from Squidstorm.
And sometimes it gives you confidence. It's a mentality thing. You do a squid bag, you do a squid dance, it gives you that like feeling of like, oh, yeah, let's go.
Mr. Kabam going to go down to the Stingray there. We're seeing Frank's Hot Dogs trying to pop this Rainmaker shield, but Tasty Waves is hanging around there trying to make sure that that doesn't happen for Squidlife Crisis. One down on the side of Squidlife Crisis as the Roller Moose is going to go down. Tasty Waves waiting to pick up that Rainmaker. The Ink Armor going to get popped as well, and they need him to get a little bit more map control before pushing forward.
And this isn't just a desire for one team to defend and one team to attack. They both need to attack. They can neither can afford to let the other person hold the Rainmaker. The point difference is so minor.
This entire set has been so aggressive, and I think both teams know that they cannot give an inch at all to either team. KD trying to push the Rainmaker here for Frank's Hot Dogs, but they're getting targeted from behind, and they'll go down immediately. Two down on the side of Squidlife Crisis, though, so this push could continue.
That was a great moment there where Blue Team was putting a lot of ink underneath KD's feet, not allowing her to move it. Oh my gosh!
The Stingray gonna melt them down. It's so dangerous in those hallways. And
chance.
Here comes Frank's Hot Dogs.
There's a chance they get more points.
Extend their lead up to 32. Every point matters. A trade there between KD and the Heavy Splatling. Two down
Almost.
On the side of Frank's Hot Dogs. Three down. It's just the Heavy Splatling remaining. Moose going on a rampage. And now Squidlife Crisis will have an opportunity to keep pushing the Rainmaker forward.
Even with the armor. The Moose just gave him a headbutt. Just gave him a bump, man. That armor is gonna be so good. It's keeping the survivability, but not right there.
Confirm that Moose do not care about your ink armor. They are wild animals only meant for killing. And here comes Genie trying to maintain the map control that Frank's Hot Dogs has built up. 25 seconds left to go as Punctual and Genie are bunched up on this left side hallway in similar stance. Mr. Kabam and Tasty Waves.
The splashdown.
They're going to go down.
Out. Oh, the Tasty
Waves. Trying to get away, going in that left-hand hallway, but that's where all the enemy ink is. Only 10 seconds left to go.
And they have to stay. Oh no!
They're gonna go down.
This is bad. This is very bad.
One chance might be left here. Katie is gonna trade.
It's a trade.
Three down.
It's available. It's available. 1 second.
Moose
with the
last one
alive. No. Hot Dog is going to win.
Oh no!
Oh my God! Hot Dog holding that win, holding that lead for so long, not even giving up a single point. But they are going to be getting the game.
And you can see the absolutely crazy reaction. It is Bedlam in that soundproof booth. Let's hear it for them as they come away with the victory. Frank's Hot Dogs taking the win in game number 7.
I want to hear this venue of applause, like erupt with claps once they actually walk out this door. And here they are, your champions. Oh my goodness. Amazing stuff to both teams. Amazing stuff to both teams. That game, we can't give that just to Hot Dogs. We gotta give that to everybody in this game. Because my gosh, that was so back and forth. The support's flying
blessed,
everywhere.
Honestly.
Oh, my.
The fact that we were able to witness that, that was just the bronze bracket final, and yet it went all the way to Game 7. They were trading games back and forth, one, and then two, and then two, and then back and forth, and we saw so many different kinds of games. We saw games that lasted all the way to overtime. We saw games that ended in just about a minute flat. We saw every single kind of game in this short best of seven set.
Look, I gotta give a warning to the audience here. If this was bronze finals, you're gonna need to consult a doctor if your heart will be able to handle silver, maybe gold, maybe top 12.
If you can get them by phone, try and get them to fax you a prescription, something that'll let you keep watching the hype that we have here at Squidstorm presented by EndGameTV. This is only the first real set of the day.
This is incredible, man. This is incredible. All the games from before, seeing all the close encounters, the close games, I'm glad we got this one on stream.
I mean, we knew, especially after the No Fear and Unsung Heroes set from yesterday, that Day 2 was going to be beyond recognition. It was going to be like nothing we had ever seen before. And so far, even just watching the bronze bracket, it has way exceeded my expectations.
No kidding. Especially seeing this many players come out, and especially in an online-dominated game such as Splatoon,
right.
You worry about the you concern that the level of play won't be as up there as online games. I don't know, man. I got plenty of entertainment out of that one.
And that's the beauty of every one of these lands. Each one gets bigger. There's more attendance at every land. I believe we have somewhere in the ballpark of around 144 total competitors here today. And that's not including all the spectators, all the parents, the people that just want to watch some amazing Splatoon 2 action. So there's no wonder that this is the premier 2017 Splatoon 2 land.
No kidding, man. It's video games that drive people together. It's hobbies. Getting people together in the same area from all around the world. We have people flown in from all these places just to play video games and to connect with hobbies. It's PAX East, for example, right? PAX
right.
East. In the last 2 or 3 years, every year it almost doubles.
Wow.
At least 1 year specifically, there was a huge doubling of it that caused chaos. Right now it's a 4-day event at PAX East. It just was up to 4 days. PAX East is not really a LAN event,
right.
But it has the same mentality of people just coming together, sharing hobbies, and finding fun. And whether it be competition, anything.
You still have that same exponential growth that you were talking about. Each LAN has gotten drastically bigger comparatively. And I just have to say, all the people here are so nice as well. You can literally walk up to anyone, whether they're on a well-known team, whether you've never met them before. You can get them to sign your poster. You can talk to them. You can make tons of new friends here that you know going into it are already going to have at least one similar interest to you.
That's right. Stingray.
I mean, yes.
I mean, and we talk about Squidstorm as a whole here.
Right.
So Squidstorm 1, I was not in attendance of it. I was not a big Splatoon 1 competitive player at the time. Mm-hmm. When it was time for Squidstorm 2, they anticipated 40, 80 something about people. When they saw in 2 days that we had not only broken that number but increased the demand, like,
oh yes,
people, they were like, okay, hold on, we have to communicate with the venue to make sure we can fit this amount of people in here, and eventually got up to 180 something people, and here we all are out here today having a good time playing some games.
We were very fortunate to be able to get the entire venue for as long as we've had it. The food here is top notch, the service is top notch, the employees here have been absolutely fantastic. They're so welcoming, so happy to have us all here, and we are happy to be in this fantastic location as well.
That's very true. This is a very good area of Boston. I've been to Boston a few different times for PAX East, for Shine 2017, 16, mm-hmm. And this is a very convenient area, especially if you pick up an Airbnb that's 7 minutes away by walking. Oh my gosh, it's so nice.
Exactly. It's my first time in Boston, so
really?
I've loved seeing it. It's historic city.
Have you checked out Shake Shack?
I have not been there yet. I've had too much good food to gobble up. I mean, the food here, they have some great sandwiches, some amazing French fries, and of course, the service, as I mentioned here, the staff is so welcoming and friendly.
Oh my gosh, yes. Definitely, definitely. Oh, sorry, is this on me? That's on them. Okay, got it.